Unit 10, Lesson 5, where we will continue to learn how to solve a quadratic by factoring. As we talked about in the last lesson, factoring is turning one polynomial into a multiplication problem of smaller, simpler polynomials. In the last lesson, we learned how to do this by taking out the GCF. In this lesson, we're going to learn how to take an expression like this and turn it into an expression like this. In order to learn that, let's start by understanding distribution a little bit better. A lot of teachers teach distribution by this acronym FOIL, which stands for first, outs, inners, and last. I prefer not to teach it that way, but it is helpful to understand how to do factoring. When you multiply the first term of each expression, we're going to get x squared. Without mixing in fractions or anything, it's pretty hard to get x squared by any other two things than x and x. So for a polynomial that starts with x squared, it most likely came from two polynomials being multiplied together that both started with an x. Now when you multiply the outsides, the x and the 2, you're going to get a term that has x to the first power, in this case 2x. The same thing is going to happen when you multiply the inside terms. 3 and x are going to multiply to give you another x term, 3x. So what you can notice is by adding the outer and inner terms, you're going to get your x term of your simplified polynomial. Now that we've multiplied the first, the outer, and the inner, we'd be left with the last. Now something of note here is both of these terms are constants without an x term. And that's how you're going to get the constant term of your resulting polynomial. So let's summarize this really quick. We're always going to have this x squared if both expressions are starting with an x. When you find your outside and inside terms, you could really just add this 3 and 2 together to figure out the coefficient of your x term. And when you multiply your last terms together, you're going to get your constant. Here's the important takeaway. These two numbers will add together to give you the coefficient with x and multiply together to give you the constant. This is going to be a really important idea that we take advantage of when we're factoring. In this section, we're going to be factoring polynomials that start with x squared and work their way down in standard form. These will all have a leading coefficient of 1, so you'll only see x squared, no number in front. The main trick we're going to do to be able to factor is making a t-chart and figuring out what multiplies to this last term and adds to this coefficient. That's all there is to this procedure, so let's take a look at some problems to understand this now. When I'm factoring, I'm going to always start with a t-chart. What multiplies to the constant and adds to the x coefficient. So for this problem, we're looking for two numbers that multiply to 2 and add to 3. The way we're going to do this is we're just going to start listing out factors of 2. It's easier to think about what multiplies to something rather than adding, because there's a lot more options for adding than there is for multiplying. Well, two numbers that I can come up with to multiply to 2 are 1 and 2. And now we ask ourselves, does that add to 3? And it does. So 1 and 2 are the two numbers I was looking for. And here's all we're going to do with those numbers. We're going to write out blank parentheses. We know that the first terms need to multiply to x squared, so they're always going to be just x and x to start off the polynomial every time. And now we're just going to take these numbers and put them into the parentheses. So we're going to write x plus 1 and x plus 2. And that's our factored form of this original polynomial. I'm just going to show you off to the side really quick that if we were to multiply these two polynomials back together, we would go right back to where we started with. So that means they're equal to each other. And we've found the factored form of the original polynomial. This is the process we're going to use for all of these factoring problems. So let's do it again in number 2. What multiplies to the constant and adds to the x coefficient? We don't see an x coefficient here, so it's 1. So we want what multiplies to negative 12 and adds to 1. Well, to multiply to a negative, one of the two numbers needs to be negative. So let's start listing out some possible factors. It could be 1 and 12, but one of them would have to be negative. So maybe it's negative 1 and positive 12. Yeah, but that adds up to 11, not 1. 1 and negative 12 could work, but that also adds up to something different than 1. That would add up to negative 11. We could try 2 and 6 with the 2 negative or the 6 negative, but those add up to 4 and negative 4 respectively. They don't add up to 1. And finally, we land on 3 and 4, which if I make the 3 negative, negative 3 plus 4 equals 1, which is what we were looking for. So those are the two numbers. So my factored form is going to be x minus 3, x plus 4. And that'll be our final answer. Now, I showed a whole lot of work over here in figuring this out. And the reason I did that was so that you could see that there is a procedural way to do this. You can really just plug and chug with all the different things that multiply to 12. But a lot of people are able to do these in their head if they just think about it for a minute. If you're one of those people that can come up with this negative 3 and 4 in your head, that's awesome. Do that. If you're a person that has a tough time coming up with those numbers on your own, then just start listing out factors and work your way down until you find the ones that work. Now we're going to keep factoring here, but now we're going to learn how to solve with factoring. And really all we need to do is we need to make sure one side's equal to 0, factor the other side, and then use the ZPP, just like we did in the last lesson. Now we're going to be nice to you and start these problems off equal to 0. So really the priority is factoring this side. I'm going to keep making my T chart off to the side. I'm going to ask myself what multiplies to negative 6 and what adds to the middle term, 5. Now again, we're multiplying to a negative here, so one of the numbers has to be negative. Well, maybe I try 2 and 3. Well, if I make the 2 negative or the 3 negative, either way it adds up to 1 or negative 1, which isn't 5. So 2 and 3 don't work. How about 6 and 1? Well, if I make the 1 negative,
6 plus negative 1
equals 5, which is what we were looking for. So those are the numbers, 6 and negative 1. So we're going to factor this into x plus 6 and x minus 1. It's still equal to 0, so we're going to rewrite equals 0. So we've now rewritten the original polynomial into a factored form. And the reason we did that is because now this allows us to solve using ZPP. We can set x plus 6 equal to 0 and solve by subtracting 6 from both sides to get x equals negative 6. And we can set x minus 1 equal to 0 and solve by adding 1 to both sides to get a final answer of x equals 1. And we get two solutions, x equals negative 6 and x equals 1. We're going to do the same kind of thing here for number 4. We make our T chart. We ask what multiplies to, in this case, 27 and adds to the coefficient, which is 12. And this time I come up with 9 and 3 right away, which add up to 12, and that works. So this factors into x plus 9 and x plus 3, and we keep it set equal to 0. I get a lot of people that ask, do you need it to be 9 and 3 or 3 and 9? And truthfully, it doesn't matter. You can put these factors in whatever order you want, and you're still going to get the same solutions. So I'm now going to use ZPP and set x plus 9 equal to 0 and x plus 3 equal to 0. That gives me solutions of negative 9 and negative 3. And this problem is done. We started with one form, factored it into another form, and then used ZPP to get our solutions. Let's show a few more here just to get the hang of this. I'm always going to start with my T chart, multiply to 8, the constant, and add to negative 6, the coefficient. Now, this one's interesting. If I list out all the factors, 1 and 8, 2 and 4, you may notice that none of these add up to negative 6. And you might be confused because this is positive, so you don't think anything should be negative. But just like a positive number times a positive number gives you back a positive, so does a negative times a negative. So you can consider that the 1 and the 8 might both be negative. Now that still doesn't work, but if I make my 2 and 4 both negative, negative 2 minus 4 does equal negative 6. So if we're trying to multiply to something positive and add to something negative, you actually have to make both of your factors negative. Now don't get confused by the fact that we have y's for this problem. It's still going to work the same way. It's just going to be y minus 2 and y minus 4. And then we're going to use ZPP to set each of those factors equal to 0. And then we solve each one, getting answers of y equals 2 and y equals 4. Here's another one in 6, just like that previous one. We're multiplying to 14 and adding to negative 9. Just like we said with the last one, because we're multiplying to a positive and adding to a negative, both of our factors should be negative. And I come up with negative 7 and negative 2. So this will factor into x minus 7 and x minus 2 equals 0. ZPP says set each one equal to 0 and solve. And we have our solutions x equals 7 and x equals 2. To summarize this lesson, in order to factor, you need to find the two numbers that multiply to the constant and add to the middle coefficient. Once you've found these two numbers and factored, you can use ZPP to solve. If you came away with anything else, write that down now. Otherwise, we'll see you in the next lesson.